Hi. Glycolysis is the topic from the chapter Respiration in Plants. This glycolysis is a metabolic process which is found in the cytoplasm of all the cells. So remember, it is a metabolic process. Metabolic process which is found in all the cells cytoplasm. So site of glycolysis is cytoplasm. All cells means all the prokaryotes and eukaryotes we are talking about. Now next point is that in this process the glucose molecule will convert into the pyruvic acid. So here we can say that in the cytoplasm, in the process of glycolysis, glucose converts into pyruvic acid. After this glycolysis process, the fate of this pyruvic acid will be decided by the presence or absence of oxygen. Like if the oxygen is present, then this pyruvic acid go for aerobic respiration, that is in the Krebs cycle, and will produce CO2 plus H2O finally. Whereas if oxygen is absent, then the pyruvic acid will go for the anaerobic respiration, that is fermentation, and will produce lactic acid or ethanol, etc. So here in this topic, we'll just talk about the glycolysis part. This glycolysis involves 10 steps in total, but in NCRT, they have included the two steps together. So according to NCRT, if we count, then there are 9 steps. But for the question in NEET exam, you have to go with the 10-step process. Remember, glycolysis is a 10-step process. We'll learn this topic stepwise. That is, I'll explain step by step. So first step we have where glucose is there. This glucose molecule will convert into the molecule glucose 6-phosphate. Or it is also known as G6P, glucose 6-phosphate. Now remember, the step one is an irreversible reaction. The first point about this step is it is an irreversible step. Second point about this step is the enzyme which is used, exokinase. This hexokinase enzyme has some particular features which I'm going to tell over here. This enzyme is a type of allosteric enzyme. Another point, they show feedback mechanism. Now, here in the conversion, ATP is used in the presence of magnesium ions. So we can say that ATP converts into ADP, and the ions in which the hexokinase enzyme becomes active is magnesium ions. Now remember, ATP is used in this step one, and this is an irreversible step. So I'll write the fourth point, ATP used. These are the points from which the questions can be asked. The second step now we are going to discuss. In the second step, the product of the first step will be used as the substrate. So we have this glucose 6-phosphate. This glucose 6-phosphate will just get isomerized into fructose 6-phosphate by the help of the enzyme known as isomerase. The name of the enzyme is isomerase. Remember, the step 2 is a reversible step. In complete glycolysis process, we'll see only 3 irreversible steps. So better you just learn the step number, which are irreversible, so that you won't have to learn separately for reversible and irreversible steps. So I'll tell you in advance, step 1, 3 and 10 are irreversible steps. Apart from that, all the steps are reversible type. That is, the products can be converted into substrates and substrates can be converted into products. Now, after the second step, we'll move towards the third step. In this third step, the fructose 6-phosphate molecules are there. These fructose 6-phosphate molecules will convert into fructose 1,6-biphosphate molecules. Now, this conversion occurs in the presence of the enzyme, which is quite similar to hexokinase enzyme, that is phosphofructokinase. Phosphofructokinase, do learn the names of these enzymes as they are important. Now, in this phosphofructokinase enzyme also, magnesium ions will be used as the cofactors, and along with this magnesium ions, the step uses the ATP just like step 1. So only the substrates and the products are different from step 1, plus the name of the enzyme is different. Rest all the points are same as step 1, so I won't be repeating over here. I'll just write same as step 1. Clear? This step 3 is also a irreversible type of step. Now, from this we'll move towards the fourth step of the glycolysis. In the fourth step, this fructose 1,6-biphosphate molecule, 1,6-biphosphate molecule will convert into a 3-carbon compound, that is PGAL and DHAP. Now remember, this PGAL and DHAP keeps interchanging by the help of the enzyme isomerase. So they are going under reversible exchange by the help of enzyme isomerase. And this conversion of fructose 1,6-biphosphate into the 3-carbon compounds is being done by the help of the enzyme known as aldolase. Now, here remember, as we all know, fructose is a 6-carbon compound, which is an isomer of glucose. So a 6-carbon molecule is actually breaking into 2 molecules of 3-carbon compound. Now, the next step involves this action on the molecules of PGAL. So starting from the fifth step, I'll talk about 2 molecules itself, as we have 2 molecules produced by 1 glucose. Okay, so 2 molecules of PGAL are there. Remember, this DHAP is converted into PGAL. So I have taken 2 PGAL directly rather than writing PGAL and DHAP separately. Now, maybe some of you might be thinking, what is this DHAP and PGAL? So before proceeding to step 5, let me just write the full names of this PGAL and DHAP. PGAL is phosphoglyceraldehyde, whereas DHAP is dihydroxyacetone phosphate. The names of these compounds are very important. Now, this 2-PGAL will convert into 2 molecules of 1,3-biPGAL. 1,3-biPGAL. Remember, the 2 molecules of PGAL are converted into 2 molecules of 1,3-biPGAL, and this is the step Remember, step 4 is also reversible type, and the step 5 is also reversible type, and this step uses no enzyme for the conversion. No enzyme is involved at step 5, and it takes the phosphates by the help of inorganic phosphate compounds like H3PO4. So no use of ATP is there, no use of enzyme is there, and this PDAL will convert reversibly into 1,3-bi-PDAL molecules. After this, we'll move towards the step number 6. In this step number 6, we have two molecules of 1,3-bi-PDAL. Now, this step number 6 involves the conversion of 1,3-bi-PDAL into two molecules of 1,3-bi-PDA. Two molecules of 1,3-bi-PDA. That is phosphoglyceric acid. So glyceraldehyde will convert into glyceric acid. This conversion involves the enzyme dehydrogenase, one of the important points we have. Step 6 involves dehydrogenase enzyme. Now, here this dehydrogenation means that the removal of hydrogen is done from this PDAL, and this PDAL will convert into the PGA. Now, who gets this hydrogen? So, NAD. NAD is going to get this hydrogen from 1,3-bi-PDAL and will convert itself into NADH2. Remember, in the case of chapter photosynthesis, we use NADP. Whereas in the case of respiration, we use the compound NAD. Now, here after the 6th step where this NADH2 is produced. Now, remember here at the 6th step, what is being produced? Another important point, NADH2 produced. Now, this NADH2. I'll tell what is the future of this NADH2, which is important. In case of aerobic respiration, when oxygen is present, it will lead to the formation of ATP by ATS system or electron transport chain system. And in the case of fermentation, it will be used by the compounds itself without producing any energy. Now we'll move towards the step number 7. The step number 7 includes the two molecules of 1,3-bi-PDA. Now here what happens? This 1,3-bi-PDA will now convert into two molecules of 3-PDA. PGA is being produced, the two molecules, and what happens over here? The enzyme transphosphorylase will help in this step. So I'll write the name of the enzyme, transphosphorylase. Now, in this step, one important point is there, that is the conversion of ADP is done into ATP. That is, now at step number 7, this ADP will convert into ATP. So we can say that at step 7, ATP is produced. Now, let's have some calculations over here. Then we'll move towards the step number 8. In this step number 6, how many molecules are there? 2. And these two molecules of 1,3-bi-PGAL are converted into two molecules of 1,3-bi-PGA. If one molecule of 1,3-bi-PGAL gives one hydrogen, So two molecules are going to use two NAD and will produce two molecules of NADH2. Remember, at step number 6, two molecules of NADH2 are produced. Now, if we look at the calculation for the step number 7, again we have two molecules of 1,3 by PGA, which converts into two molecules of 3-PGA. So one molecule will use one ADP to form one ATP. So two molecules are going to use two molecules of ADP and will form two molecules of ATP. So remember, at step number 7, how many molecules of ATP we are getting? We are getting two molecules of ATP. We can say two ATP gain is there at step number 7. Two ATP gain. One ATP per molecule of 1,3 by PGA. Now, after this, we'll move towards the next step, that is step number 8. In this step number 8, there's two molecules of 3-PGA. Two molecules of 3-PGA are there. Sorry, two molecules of 3-PGA. Now, it will convert into the two molecules of 2-PGA. That is just the position of phosphate group changes in the organic compound. So two molecules of 2-PGA is being produced. Now, here in this step, the enzyme used is mutase enzyme. I'll just write the name of the enzyme. Mutase enzyme. Now, after this, we have step number 9. In this step number 9, the compound used is two molecules of 2-PGA. These two molecules will convert into two molecules of 2-PEP, phosphoenol pyruvate. 2-PEP. Two molecules of 2-PEP are produced. Now, here the enzyme involved is enolase enzyme. Okay, now this step 9 is followed by the last step of glycolysis, that is step number 10. The final step, we know that the final product of glycolysis is pyruvic acid, and we have already known the substrate of the step number 10, that is two molecules of 2-PEP. These molecules will convert into two molecules of pyruvic acid. Two molecules of pyruvic acid. And remember, as I told you, step number 10 is actually a irreversible reaction. So the enzyme used here is pyruvate kinase. Pyruvate kinase enzyme. Clear? And here at the step number 10 also, we get the two molecules of ADP converted into two molecules of ATP. So here at step number 10, what is the net gain of the ATP? Here at step number 10 also, we get two ATPs. So if we calculate the net gain of ATP by the process of glycolysis, then at step 1, there is use of 1 ATP, so I'll use minus 1 ATP. At step number 3, there is use of another 1 ATP, so I'll write minus 1 ATP. At step number 7, we got 2 ATP, so I'll write plus 2 ATP. And at step number 10, again we got 2 ATPs. I'll write plus 2 ATP. So if the question in the exam asks you that what is the net gain of the ATP only by the process of glycolysis or at substrate level phosphorylation, then your answer will be 2 ATPs are produced by substrate level phosphorylation or by direct process only the glycolysis. The glycolysis, if only is concerned, then we get 2 ATPs. This is why in the case of anaerobic respiration, the gain of only 2 ATPs is there. These 2 ATPs are gained by the process of glycolysis only. Further, from the pyruvic acid, there is no gain of the ATP. This pyruvic acid, which is produced by the glycolysis, a 3-carbon compound, will now go into the mitochondria. When the cell is going for the aerobic respiration, the eukaryotic cell, and the process it goes under is the link reaction, where it forms acetyl coenzyme A. So stay tuned to study further about this link reaction and Krebs cycle. Please like, share, subscribe this channel and share with your friends to help them out with the topics of the biology.